Guys, welcome. My name is Ankush. I am a pre-sales engineer at RSA. I worked in a SOC for a very long time. I'm super excited for all of you to be here and being part of my story here on metrics. So these are operational metrics, as Josh mentioned in the previous talk, that these are more practitioner-oriented metrics that you can just take and apply in your own SOC. So we'll start with that. So let me try to analyze the current situation. Anyone who has been a sports person would really understand that in order to keep improving and measuring your current performance, you need to keep a score, right? So same thing with SOC, but the challenge becomes really harder because in SOC there are so many moving parts, right? It's so complex, it touches every corner of your enterprise, right? And anything that changes within your organization, whether your organization digital transformation strategy to move to cloud, that has a big impact on how your SOC performs, right? So that's where the problem is, that the senior executives and the SLT teams don't really get to see the performance from the SOC team, and they lose confidence and subsequently budget, and you guys and overall SOC team tends to lose very talented people because of that. They're doing really good show, but they're not able to show it to the senior management what they're doing. So I'm going to address that topic today. So what is the motivations for this session? As I said, in my view, the problem is, again, not the metrics. I think each and every SOC team has some sort of metrics, but are they getting derived from a framework? And again, this talk is not about a specific framework. You can use any framework like the last talk. You can use any framework that you like, but it's important to use one framework so that your metrics program is consistent. And just by the way, this slide is on the website, so you guys can refer to everything after the talk as well. So, so that's the problem, right? The framework is missing. And so what I'm going to do is show you some of the things that I've done, used a framework, which not only helps to identify the metrics from your SOC capabilities, but also how do you measure and act upon them, right? So as I said, the framework is an abstract concept, right? You need to put something like a functional aspect to it in order for you to give results. I can actually put this framework on how to fly a plane, right? It will work the same way. But if I have to apply this framework to SOC capabilities, then I have to first identify what are my SOC capabilities that I'm looking for. Then linking that back to metrics, and then how do those metrics give me outcomes? So I have coined a term myself this morning, which is framework-derived actionable metrics, FDAM, right? So if your metric is not actionable, then obviously it's not going to be of any use. It's going to be something like that Norse globe map that you see on the website. So some of the metrics, this is just a quick snapshot what we are going to talk about today. But before we deep dive into this, this is something that I've cooked already. I would like to also give you some perspective of how I have arrived at these metrics, okay? So that's where we are going to talk about the ingredients for this recipe as well. So one of the biggest, in my view, simple to understand framework is GQIM. I am sure all of you would know, being in security industry, this was the work done by Carnegie Mellon in 2014 by Katie Stewart. So this is out there. So it's very simple to understand. You have an objective, okay? And I'm taking examples so that it makes sense. Reading that becomes a little difficult. If you have an objective, that objective can be a very high-level objective or a mandate that has been given by the board to the CISO with some budget, okay? So that can be as simple as this one, right? But when you start breaking down that objective, you come out with a couple of goals, right? For this particular objective, I can have 20 goals if I have to do this within my own organization, or rather in a MSSP mode as well. So one of the goals can be have a full-fledged 24/7 SOC team in place, So that is one of the goals. There can be many goals. You can have threat intelligence team, you can have malware reversing teams, and all these will become goals that subsequently you will have metrics for. So it's very important to link your business objective with the goals that you are trying to achieve. And it comes directly from there. So it's very high level, whatever your mission statement is, whatever your charter is as a SOC team, you start from there, okay? And then comes questions. So questions is very simple. This is a particular question that helps you answer the current state of the goal, right? How rapidly I'm progressing towards that goal. So very simple question. So in this case, how many resources I need to run a 24/7 SOC? Very simple question. I will have multiple of these questions again for a single goal. So it will be one to many mappings, right? I'm just taking one example right now. And then indicator is something that will help me answer that question. It is an artifact, it is a data point, which can be very, very raw, which cannot be sort of shown to a senior leadership team, but it helps me answer that question in a particular way, right? So that becomes an indicator, and in this case, it can be number of analysts in shift. Very simple example. A metric will be some sort of trend that you would want to understand, because that is something which is actionable, right? A trend, a mathematical like mean time to acknowledge those kind of things. So that will become your metric, and that will help you understand and over a period of time how your performances are measuring. So that's the framework, okay? As I said, framework is very, very abstract. I can use this framework in any different scenario. So when I apply this to SOC, right, I need to know all the goals or capabilities, as I would like to call them, to understand what metrics I would get at the end, right? So this is the term that I like to use, the capability triad. And these are three very important functions each and every SOC should have, okay? One is operations, which is your 24/7 team, okay? So what they do is, you know it all, right? Detection, incident response, 24/7 monitoring, eyes on glass stuff. And then the second thing is your engineering and IT. The team that supports the tool, the team that actually has access, admin access to all the tools in your organization and makes the changes. Okay, they might not necessarily be from a functional side, from a security background, but they are administrators and understand the tools much better than anyone in the organization. So that's the engineering and IT, and also content management. Again, putting in all the rules, right? They might not have the hypothesis or understanding of how the rules or alerts or use cases are created, but at least they understand what is the syntax for that particular tool. And then the blue and the red team, which can also be called as content team, again. So they are basically the owners of the content, right? Who decide what needs to be monitored, and they have a good understanding of the domain as well as the current security landscape. So if you are moving towards cloud, you need to have a person in your blue and red team or the content team who understands cloud security landscape very well, so that he can actually come up with hypotheses and test them and prototype them and then give it back to the engineering and IT team to implement. So as you can see, it's becoming like a Venn diagram, right? And there are a lot of overlaps because these are not siloed teams. As I said, you need to have these three together and work in a coherence unit for SOC to be successful. So we'll quickly look at some of the things that exchange from one team to another. For example, operations and engineering team, right? If any time a new tech is onboarded, the engineering team will give training to the operations team, and vice versa. If a new content is onboarded, the engineering team will let know the operations team as well, right? Again, between engineering team and the content team, right? So there will be requests where maybe because of some pen test or some new vulnerability that has come out, the content team might push out a request for some rules to be implemented. So that exchange will happen there. And then the last one is between the content team and the operations team, right? So that is essentially in terms of how content is, how much efficient my content is. That can be one area, and then also in terms of investigations. So if they are looking at some particular alert, why that alert is working, and they don't have any idea, then they can talk to each other, right? So this becomes a triad, and obviously all these teams work together, share information, and let it pass a bit. And then the last part is governance and PMA. You need project management guys to help you with this overall project or a mini SOC that you have in place, right? Someone has to be able to look at these three different teams from a different perspective, and I will come to what the main role of the project management and governance team is. So this is the SOC capability triad. Now, if we mix this with the framework, we get something like this. So this is an Excel sheet. I'm sure it's not visible from the back, but if you can look at the blue line, that the first column is the business objective, what we just saw in the GQM framework. So what I'm doing is I'm putting all the capabilities, SOC capabilities that we just spoke about in the goal section and trying to come answer questions, extract indicators, metrics, and then what are the supporting decisions? As I said, framework derived actionable metrics. So what are the supporting decisions or actions we can take when we are talking about that particular metric? So now we will deep dive some of the operational metrics for each of these capabilities. And I will start with the first one. So this is very important from a resourcing standpoint. Number of analysts per shift per day, right? How many number of alerts you have in a day? What is your mean time to acknowledge? I'm sure everybody understands that terminology, right? How quickly your analyst can pick up the alert from the queue and make it from a new one to in progress. That's it, nothing else. Mean time to decision, how quickly your analyst, and this is not containment or remediation, by the way, how quickly your analyst can actually triage stuff and decision on it, whether I have to block it or this is a false positive. So that's where we from your SIM or wherever you can get this data point, and that can actually help you understand how many analysts you need on a particular shift. Maybe I am a 8-to-5 shop in America only. I don't need to have people who after 5 p.m. I can have very thin resourcing as well. And then if you are MSSP, then you can also look at some of these SLAs. You want to have MTTA less than 12 hours. So how many resourcing you need for that, depending upon how many alerts you're getting. Next one, alert true positive rate. Very, very important. I think people don't measure this metric a lot within the organization. It's very easy to measure. Anytime you action something, which is confirmed positive, like you block something, that's a true positive within the organization. So why this is important, right? It actually shows how effective my SOC is. If my SOC is not blocking anything, or if my SOC is not having any alert true positive alert, then it's basically not doing anything, right? So again, this metric, I'm not saying that it should be owned by the operation team. It's something that the operation team should measure, but it has to be, specifically this one has to be owned by the content team, because they are putting in all the content. The operation team is just detecting and responding as per their incident response procedures, right? So they have to be responsible, and you have to internally discuss and work out what is the number for you. I have seen in the operations I was working, 20%, 25% is a good number, very good number. Roughly, this number would be between 10 to 15% if you are a mature SOC. If you are not very mature, then probably less than 5% as well. Okay, but this is important in order to understand where you are going. If you have been in industry, or if you have been a SOC for 3-4 years and still your number is very low, then you can get the sense that you need some change. Number of incidents escalated. Again, this is for like you need investigation support. You don't have people who know NKs. and other things in your team. So this can actually help you understand whether you need an outsourcing team who helps you with the investigations or not. How many people you need there, or if you want to have internal capability from an investigation standpoint, how many people, at what point in time you need on call, those kind of things. Again, from a content true positive rate, okay? So we talked about alert true positive. This particular is interesting because if there is a particular content which is very high, then it shows that there is a behavior issue, okay? And I will take a simple example. For example, a particular division in your organization has a high phishing or clicking rate on things, right? So obviously, the SLT team needs to know that the people have to be more given more training, and so that they can control that problem. It's not just about SOC every time detecting everything. Okay, so that can also help you understand how you can actually shift stuff from SOC to some of the other proactive controls or preventative controls. And then lastly is type of action taken and time taken for implementation. Okay, again, this is more for the subordinate functions which support the SOC team. For example, your IT team, if you have given them an IP address to block in a firewall or a domain on proxy, and they are taking 15 hours, I don't know, to block them, then that has to be tracked. And that has to be discussed within meetings that, hey, this is unsustainable and we need people on call to support us in case of any emergency. And the last one is false positive rates. Okay, again, both from alert and content perspective. Again, these two should also be owned by the content team, which basically, it should be part of their goals, and they should help to decrease this number to less than 15%. That's where I like to have some, that's my suggestion. So that's from a SOC operation standpoint. So next, we will come to the engineering IT. Before going into that, I think I just want to quickly touch on the subject of Sec DevOps. I'm sure all of you understand agile methodology. And if we have to, as a SOC, if I have to move with the same pace as IT is moving, I also have to adopt some of the agile methodologies in my SOC as well. Okay. So there are basically two methodologies within the agile framework, Scrum and Kanban. One, I will just highlight a simple difference between both of them. One, for Scrum, it is a release cycle. So it can be a 2 weeks, 4 weeks, whatever you're comfortable with, but you commit to something and you deliver that at the end of the sprint, okay? There's no changes after that. The next one is Kanban, which is more of an ad hoc style methodology where you can, it's like run support. If something comes up urgent, you handle that and then move to the next thing. So you deprioritize stuff and prioritize most more important things. So things can change, and it's more for things which come up, and things do come up as well. So these are the two methodologies that we will implement, and I have implemented in the Sec DevOps team or the engineering team that we are going to talk about. So based on these two methodologies, the metrics will be very different. So now we will talk about the SOC engineering and IT metrics. The first one is the build metric. So I've divided the metrics in two parts. One is build and run, okay? Because obviously you need teams who work on building stuff in a release and in a planned way, and then you need support from IT and content to actually help you in an ad hoc way as well. For example, if there is an issue with the tools, then you need their support as well, okay? But they work together to release new tool sets and new content as well in a very planned way as well. So from a build perspective, the most important metric is what is the number of content that was released within this sprint, okay? And that can be number of rules, alerts, whatever, and how many were blocked, which we were not able to release because of XYZ reason. Reason can be, I don't understand the syntax, so take help from the OEM. I don't have any way to measure if this is working or not, whatever. So we will use Jira for all these, by the way. And the next one is, what is my current backlog? So if I'm using, from a content team perspective, I'm using MITRE ATT&CK framework, and I know what is green, what is red, and I want to cover that gap, so I will have a pipeline, and then I will work on that. So this will become a backlog, and then I will have a periodic sprint for the roadmap to cover all the content. The next one is from a platform perspective. Again, new log sources getting onboarded, new content, new tools getting onboarded. For example, if you bought a SOAR tool or EDR tool, and that becomes part of the cycle. If you are decommissioning something old, that becomes part of the cycle. So these are all planned stuff for the SOC engineering and IT team. And the last one is the run content, which is more Kanban stuff, which is more ad hoc, right? For example, if I released an alert or a logic to SOC operations team, and they are getting 500 alerts in an hour for that stuff, someone has to look at that and tune that. And based on the feedback, whether that feedback is, hey, we use MS Build, our development team uses MS Build, so that's not necessarily something bad in our environment, and I need to whitelist all my developer zone for that particular alert. And as I said, issue support and troubleshooting. So this becomes some of the things which basically a SOC engineering and IT team should measure and assign ownership to each and everything, who is responsible for what metric. And lastly, the content team. Okay, so as I said earlier, this should be the primary vector or metric to measure the content team. What is my true positive rate and what is my false positive rate? Very easy to capture from the SOC operations, and this can help you understand how effective your detections are and vice versa as well. The other part is you can use MITRE ATT&CK coverage if you want to, not necessarily, you may have something else as well, and then see what is my pipeline, okay? What is my content pipeline? How am I doing from that perspective? And then how many content requests I am adding to the SOC engineering team for them to implement this week or sprint. And then how many content requests I am working from a work in progress perspective. So this is again linked directly with threat hunting as well, the same concept here. So you have a hypothesis and you are doing threat hunting and you identify some particular gap in your detection, and then you test it and release it back to the SOC engineering for testing. And the last one is attack quotient, which is again something which is hard to measure. If you remember the keynote in the morning, Rohit said that preparing for the worst may not prepare you for the likelihood, right? So similar concept, work with your threat intel, work if you don't have one, work with the vendor, work with your pen testers, and look at what are the most likely threats within your organization. The top 10 should be enough if you haven't done that exercise before. And then build your content for that. MITRE is okay, but how do you prioritize those 10 columns, right? This is how you should prioritize that. So this is for the content team. And lastly, as I said, for the PMO, project management office, they are really the auditors within the overall scheme of things, who are looking at, as I said, the Venn diagram and how the exchange of information is happening between all these three teams and how they're performing and communicating that back to the senior management and also within the teams as well. So one of the most important is some sort of a program where you can do self-assessment or within the team to help understand what are my skill gaps. Okay, so you can use NIST-NICE framework, which is based on knowledge, skills, and abilities, but you can use something else as well, or you can adapt this nice framework to your requirement. What that helps in understanding what is my budget that I need, and what are the trainings that my team need, which can be tool-based trainings or functional or domain knowledge as well, okay? And as I said, from an audit perspective, looking at some of the alerts, triage that has been done by the SOC operations team, and see if they are following the incident response procedures correctly or not. So that can, again, give you some assurance that it's not just numbers, the underlying response procedures are also getting followed. Because a lot from a quality standpoint can get lost when you're just looking at those numbers, how many alerts, what we did, and those kind of things. And again, have a SOC dashboard for visualization and linking that back to some sort of an incentive plan for the for managing your talent and keeping the high performers. So that's pretty much it what I have today. I would like to just recap. So one of the most important thing is use a framework, because the framework will help you wherever you want to add a capability. For example, if you have these three basic capabilities, that's good. But if you want to add another capability like threat intelligence, it's very easy. Just add that in the Excel sheet and you can use any framework and you can come out with the metrics and then start measuring yourself using that. So use a framework, identify your current capabilities, start putting those capabilities in the framework, identify the metrics, identify the outcomes, the actions, and then do periodic assessment with your program management team to help understand where you currently are. And I don't have this Excel sheet because everything came from that, all the metrics, but I will be happy to share that with the team here if they can send it out to everyone. I'm not sure, but you can connect with me as well and I'd be happy to share with that. So with that, any questions? The last time I was on stage like this and have so much light was when I was getting married in India. So this is a bit like that. Any questions? Okay, thank you so much, guys.